Thank you. Hello, welcome to an adventure. I'm gonna ask you all right now at the top of stream to let me know how my voice is against the music, because I had some sound issues in the setup today, and I don't know if it's a good balance. So everybody who's here, welcome. I need your support. Let me say hi, though, to Key Squared. Welcome back. Thank you so much for the resubscription at 15 months. Woo! And Lord Portico, hello. It's good to see you. Hi, Fluid Ant. Music is too loud. I'm a little soft compared to the music. All right. We will attempt to adjust. Okay. I have lowered the music volume the quickest way that I could. Let me know if that's better. If not, I can up my volume, but that requires me to walk across the room. So let me know how that is. Today was interesting to set up for, and you'll see why when we get to the actual materials that we're looking at. I'm on. Yeah, okay, it's fine. The camera is, like, I was off center and it bothered me when I saw it. Okay, it's better now? Awesome. Just gonna make you all slightly bigger for me in the looking at text bit. So I am presently, I have three computers and an iPad going, but the computers are further away from me than normal because the materials we're looking at today are really big. So it's gonna be fun. Let me go ahead and jump in. I do need to just switch that computer over. I just realized this will be a slight issue. One second. I have to be able to scroll this page while I read. Okay. Semi-reliably informed today that it's Hagfish Day. Happy Hagfish Day. Please do not hug a hagfish. We'll get there in a moment. Since you brought it up in chat, and this is an educational stream, we'll find out what Hagfish Day is. But first, we always start this program by reading the land acknowledgement and labor recognition from the university. Also, let me do my actual, Fluid Ann, thank you so much for the Prime subscription. Welcome back for 10 months. Welcome to an adventure. I'm Anthony Wright Day Hernandez, Community Collections Archivist here at Virginia Tech. And if you're here to see some archive things, then you're in the right spot. This stream goes out on twitch.tv/VTULstudios, that stands for Virginia Tech University Libraries Studios, as well as twitch.tv/Rogan27, which is my personal Twitch channel. So I've got two chats in front of me. I can respond to either room, but yes, This is a weekly program where I share things from the archives here at Virginia Tech. And we'll get to what we're looking at today in just a moment. Did you give a, you gave a shout out to the Libraries Channel. Thank you. Indeed, the Libraries Channel, this is not the only program on the channel. There are other shows. I don't know what they're all doing right now or exactly what the schedule is, but I do know that at odd times on Monday afternoon, I believe starting at like 3:30 in the afternoon, there is another Archives-related show whose name I cannot recall at the moment. I feel really bad. One second. I'm gonna find out. Because I should know it. Also, it is rather warm in here, so if you hear the sound of a fan, it's to keep me from dying. It is the exact opposite of my office, which is frigid. It's called All Aboard. A show on Monday nights, or Monday afternoons, Eastern time, on twitch.tv/VTULstudios called All Aboard, where they are taking an old board game from our archives and learning about it, learning the rules, and then using our makerspace to make a brand new copy of it for the purposes of actually playing it on stream. They've had two episodes so far. I believe the next one is coming up on the 31st. And so if you're interested in that, you should check them out at twitch.tv/VTULstudios on Monday afternoons. All right, now that I have digressed, let's do this. Forgot it was two button presses. Land acknowledgement and labor recognition. Virginia Tech acknowledges that we live and work on the Tutelo and Monacan people's homeland, and we recognize their continued relationships with their lands and waterways. We further acknowledge that legislation and practices like the Morrill Act of 1862 enabled the Commonwealth of Virginia to finance and found Virginia Tech through the forced removal of Native nations from their lands, both locally and in Western territories. We understand that honoring Native peoples without explicit material commitments falls short of our institutional responsibilities. Through sustained, transparent, and meaningful engagement with the Tutelo and Monacan peoples and other Native nations, we commit to changing the trajectory of Virginia Tech's history by increasing Indigenous student, staff, and faculty recruitment and retention, diversifying course offerings, and meeting the growing needs of all Virginia tribes and supporting their sovereignty. We must also recognize that enslaved Black people generated revenue and resources used to establish Virginia Tech and were prohibited from attending until 1953. Through Inclusive VT, the institutional and individual commitment to Ut Prosim, that I may serve, in the spirit of community, diversity, and excellence, we commit to advancing a more diverse, equitable, and inclusive community. Going to throw that announcement over in the other channel as well. So thank you, as always, for appreciating the commitment that has been given by the institution that owns all of the materials we look at on this show, and allowing me to read that commitment out weekly. I think it's important that we pay attention to. So, what we're looking at today, this is one of our finding aids, and they are housed on Archival Resources of the Virginias, which is arvasarchives.org, I think. Yes, arvasarchive.org. Anyway, we are looking at the Vera Jansone Architectural Collection, circa 1940s, 1961 to 75. Thank you, Lord Portico, for dropping that in there. I've got it in the other chat as well. So let's find out a little bit about this collection. Starting with, who is Vera Jansone? Born in Latvia, Vera Jansone studied architecture, engineering, and art history at the University of Latvia. Following World War II, Jansone left her homeland to accept a scholarship to study at the Ecole des Beaux Arts from 1945 to 1949, the School of Beaux Arts. After which she worked full-time at the Atelier Le Corbusier on the reconstruction of Paris. Upon receiving her French license, Jansone started practicing with J.L. Umbert. I should have practiced. I don't practice for this show. J.L. Umbert, working mostly on schools, housing, hospitals, and commercial buildings. In 1950, Jansone was awarded full tuition and travel expenses under an American Association of University Women scholarship to attend the Illinois Institute of Technology, where she studied under Mies van der Rohe. Jansone received her MS in architecture from the Illinois Institute of Technology in 1952. After returning briefly to Paris, Jansone moved to the United States, first living in New York for a short duration, and then later moving with her husband to California in the early 1960s, where job opportunities were much more abundant for women architects. Some of her projects include the Fox Plaza, while working with Victor Guillen Associates, underground stations for the Bay Area Rapid Transit System, while working with Ernst Born, the Mount Shasta Mall in Redding, California, while working at Robert B. Lyles Incorporated, and the Sycamore Medical Building while working with T. Lyles and Associates. This collection has 89 drawings documenting her career as a student at the Ecole Nationale Superieure des Beaux-Arts in Paris and as a professional architect in California. Her student work is comprised of drawings of the Atelier Labro, Atelier Perret, and Atelier Auguste Perret. Her later work includes drawings from the Mount Shasta Mall in Redding, commercial development in Vancouver, Washington, Pearl Ridge Shopping Mall in Honolulu, and also included are drawings from the Del Norte Medical Center, BART Civic Center, Crescent Beach, California renderings, Fox Plaza Rapid Transit, and various stations and parks in San Francisco. Additionally, the collection contains an article in the OWA Tour of Residences Designed by Women Architects in Marin County and Napa Valley. So, that should give you a sense of what we have available. There is a container list, and so if you do see something on this list that you would like to see on stream, do let me know. I believe I grabbed all of the boxes and all of the folders. So if there's something you're particularly interested in seeing, let me know in chat. I will make it a priority to show it on stream. But yeah, so if you are at all familiar with art history, some of the names that appeared in the biographical note should be familiar. First, Ecole des Beaux-Arts, very famous. Le Corbusier, also very famous. I don't know J.L. Umbert, which is partly why I don't exactly know if I'm saying his or their name properly. But Mies van der Rohe, also huge, huge name. So I'm interested to see, we can talk a little bit more about them if you would like. Let me get this computer out of the way here. And one moment. I thought I was gonna clean my glasses, but I'm not, because of everything I carted up here for the show, I did not bring anything to clean my glasses with. So, who wants to look at some art? Oh, this is my bad. I was showing you behind the scenes. What an odd display today. Oh, okay. We should be a little better now. Also, I'm gonna have to remember that I need to be left of where I want, where I'm set up to be. There, am I centered? You got distracted by a student, came back to the very, to be very confused with the behind the scenes view. All right, okay, I think we're good now. The camera is off center today, and so now I have moved me and the table in front of me. That won't work, never mind. I'm just gonna have to deal with being off center. That's what's gonna happen. As you know, part of the adventure is the chaos, because I literally have a very little bit of time to set up the stream every week, and always something is off kilter. Anyway, how about we switch to the document view, which I have too many things in front of me. These really are really large items this week, which is why it's a little bit more chaos than normal. Because I freed up the entire table in front of me to be used for showing items. And what you see in front of you right now is a piece of white paperboard that I prepared in advance so that we wouldn't end up seeing through any of the materials this week. It was a little bit dimmer than I wanted, and I can adjust these lights as we go because I want you all to be able to see the things as we look at them. And I feel like they're shadow. We'll figure it out. Live studio production. Now I feel like things are not great. Well, rather than me adjusting it for a blank canvas, how about I put something up there? How about I start with oversized folder number one. This folder takes up the entire table. It is large. And because I really don't even have enough space to open the folder, I'm going to pull the things out of the folder and put them on top of the folder. And we'll see. I don't want. I want these to be lit well. Right now they're not. I want you all to be able to see them. I actually think that's better. What if I do this? It's always an experiment. But I'm getting better at knowing what I need for which type of materials. But having a space big enough to handle these architectural drawings is new. I did not used to have enough space to be able to do these. So I'm still getting used to them. I presume this camera does auto white focus, but white balance. Auto white balance is on, so I don't know, I think we're good. Unless you all see glaring problems with it. I'm just gonna look at this and we'll move forward. I feel like I can figure out a way to light it better without washing it out. But that will take some experimentation. So, oversized folder one. I don't know what these things are, but that's part of the point. Looks like we've got drawings for the Del Norte Medical Center in Crescent City, California. Do we know anything about the Del Norte Medical Center? I'm going to attempt to find out. All right, so the drawings that we've got right now. I'm not finding like a good easy summary. There's a health center, but I don't know if that is this. I'm guessing it's not. No worries. It's an archival collection. Looking stuff up on the internet, we're not always going to find something. Vera Jansone, architect. I had to look up how to pronounce this name in given her Latvian background. That was the pronunciation I was able to find. 120 23rd Avenue, San Francisco, California. Do not scale drawings, revisions note, information for site plan from survey. Okay, structural engineer, Ellison Cedric structural engineering. Let's see. Ah, this is the site and roof plan. Uh, 23rd Avenue, Lord Portico. And I realize now, I brought this whole thing out, this whole like white thing, the paperboard, so that we wouldn't have the table showing through. And I should look at one drawing at a time on it. Because that is also helping. Although, gosh, the lighting. Okay, we're gonna try one more thing. Oh, don't do that. My lights want to be recalcitrant. Come here. No, stop that. We're gonna get this. It's going to work. It's going to work. It's going to work. How's that? Lighting wise. For the item. We still have some shadow over here that I could try to address. I don't know if it'll work though. Twenty-third Avenue is in the Sunset District in the western part of San Francisco. The area is largely single-family residential homes. Well, this was a design from the 1960s. There's the problem. All of this lighting is warm and this is cold. That's why it's messing with the lighting of the thing. It's just, it's the wrong color light and it looks wrong, and so it's going away. Okay, I'm done. I'm done playing with the lighting. We're actually gonna look at this architectural drawing. Huzzah. All right, I can zoom in if you all would like. There's no reason I cannot. And I think it would make sense to zoom in just a little so that maybe you all can see some of the detail and such. So there's some notes here at the top. Go in a bit further. No official curb grades exist. New T/C elevation shall match an elevation on paved streets approximately. Assumed no city datum exists, no sidewalk exists for construction and scored joints. All right, so that's the note. There's a list of interior materials and a finish schedule for all sorts of different things. So the entry, let's see if we can make out what this means. So this, I'm reading plywood and screen and concrete block and screen. So even not really being trained in how to read things like this, I can get a little bit. I don't know what the finish here means. I have no idea what V-I-N-A-S-B means here as far as the finish is concerned. But you can see, I mean, that chart that was drawn by hand, mind you, has a total of 38 items on it, plus an extra note on number 19. That they need lead lining for the x-ray room. This is very detailed. But let's see what we can see of the drawing itself. So this looks to be 10th and C Streets, though. So the 23rd Avenue address, Lord Portico, that was, I believe, her home address, or her where she was working as. So I'm guessing 23rd was still single family residential homes. That is the address under her name on here. This building appears to be the block between C and D Streets and 9th and 10th Streets. And I believe this is in Crescent City, so not even San Francisco, unless, I don't know where Crescent City is, whether Crescent City is part of San Francisco or outside of it, but this is Crescent City, California, between 9th and 10th Streets and C and D Streets. So I don't really have a pointer. I have a pencil. I have a pencil that I will point with. And bonus points to you if you can figure out what pencil it is. So, asphalt pavement, drainage swale, RCP storm drain, so, and then asphalt on this side again. It's block 108. And so it looks like the main building is here. The building that's being designed is in this area here. You can see, oh, these are pine trees.
Wow.
Okay, so this is because she's rendering the entire block. So we've got, this is a 28-inch pine tree, a 30-inch pine tree, two 24-inch pine trees. Building E, there's E, a building to remove. Then there's another building here, and two more buildings there. It looks like parking for a total of 25 parking spaces. Crescent City is a small town on the California coast, not far from the Oregon border. So there's a total of 25 parking spots. 9 through 25 are over here. 1 through 8 are right there. There's a sidewalk here. Final floor elevation, 55 feet. Top crawl space elevation, 51 feet, 4 inches. This is going to be an angled or sloped roof. So this line down the center here would be the peak of the roof. And then you can see the notation of slope here. It doesn't give degrees at that spot. I assume somewhere on here it does. But I'm not exactly seeing it myself. But also, you can see there's two 18-inch pine trees to be removed that would otherwise be in the building. Neat. I'm not sure what this is, but whatever this is slopes into the building. It's interesting. It's neat. I think the architectural drawings that we've looked at on stream have all been very interesting to look at, even though I don't really know everything about what we're like looking at. Pull over a second one here. Move the first one out. Again, if there's something in the finding aid that you particularly want to see, do let me know, because I can prioritize. Otherwise, I'm just gonna go through and we'll look at things as we find them interesting. This is the main floor plan. Okay, let me see. What did you throw in there? Google Maps? Oh, Maps link, gotcha. Okay, Maps. Maps brought me to not whatever you were trying to link. But I'm guessing it's because of the way that it linked. So let me attempt once more and just see what we've got. Whoa! Oh gosh, that is the look at it. I'll pull it up. I pulled it up on my monitor where I see the chat. But I'll pull it up so I can show it to all of you. And no, don't go to sleep. If anybody knows how I can force a Windows laptop to never put the screen to sleep, I would thank you profusely for it. All of the settings have been told never, ever, 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 ever go to sleep, and it goes to sleep anyway. And when it goes to sleep, I lose control of the camera that is showing you the documents. Anyway. We have a street view of the corner of 9th and D Streets. Which were... Alright, 9th and D. So yes, this building right in front of us here is sitting where this architectural drawing is drawn. It looks like whatever is currently there is not what this drawing is. This building that is sitting on the spot is not the building in these drawings. So I'm guessing that it, if it was ever built, it was torn down and something else put in its place, because that is not it. I could zoom in, but I just want to see what that sign says. Not that one, this one. Yeah, it's an optometrist's office now, but it definitely does not appear to be the building that was in the drawing. I say that because the placement is different. This is a long rectangular building, and what was actually there on the street view is more of a square-shaped building. This has the slope going parallel to D, with the peak of the sloped roof is parallel to D Street. The peak of the sloped roof of the building that's in Google Street View is parallel to 9th Street. So that was the lot where this drawing is for, but the building that is currently there is not this building. Also, this has skylights. And that one didn't. But that's fine. Let's take a look at what was planned for the interior. The main floor plan. So I believe this will be the main entrance over here somewhere. Got planters. Yeah, I'm guessing this will be the entrance here, because we've got reception, security, and the insurance office in a little like office bundle here. And then we've got two waiting rooms, one west waiting room and one east waiting room. And then another set of doors here. And then we've got examining rooms around the outside. So we have examining, consultation, exam, consultation, exam, physical therapy. On this side, exam, consulting, exam, endoscopic exam, endoscopy. What is endoscopy? If anybody knows. Otherwise, I'll look it up, because I can't recall specifically. Is that external? Then there's the doctor's library. Oh, that's nice. The doctor's library, they have a toilet in the doctor's library, so that would be sort of like a private space where the doctor could go, and they've got their own bathroom area, toilet area. There's the nurse's lounge with their own toilet area. Back here, I believe this is external to the building. There's a planter and a bench and stuff like that here. I'll check. I don't remember. Oh no, it's internal. So, and yeah, endoscopy, that is where they snake a camera down your throat. I was thinking it was a much more general for some reason, but no, it's not. It's literally tube insertion down your throat to check for stuff. So there's a whole endoscopic exam room down here. You've got a treatment room, a nurse's station, x-ray office, lab Y, x-ray corridor, x-ray room. Important. This was the room that needed to be lead lined, 2-inch lead lining, dark room, mechanical equipment, so the furnace, water, heater, etc. Restrooms. I think that's everything. Seems like a simple little clinic. Let's see what else we got. Got to figure out how to be better at moving these. All right, more drawings of that same building, the Del Norte Medical Center. So this is a side view from 9th Street, it looks like. South entrance, marble tile on concrete blocks, apparently. North entrance, west elevation, east elevation, 9th Street elevation. Yeah. So this is showing us the sides and the two entrances. I don't know. I think this is all kind of pretty cool. But I know very little about architecture. Let's see what else we got. I'm not gonna look at everything for this one medical center. So what else do we have in here? Nope, that's more of the medical center. Del Norte Medical Center. Yeah, I think folder one here was just the medical center. How about if I go from the finding aid and pick something that sounds cool? Instead of picking at random for the next thing? I need to figure out how to get this back in the folder without dying from the oversizedness of it. And without destroying it. We're gonna get it. It's very large pieces of paper. Come on, folder. Also, somewhere on iawa.lib.vt.edu, you should be able to see these drawings, I presume, because they have been scanned. I cannot guarantee that they have been put online yet, but they are completely digitized and were done as part of a project that was intended to put them online. So I believe they're up there. Yeah, that was harder than I thought it was gonna be sitting down at this tiny table. All right, how about we choose something from the finding aid? Atelier Labro, 9 drawings. Atelier Auguste Palais, Atelier Perret. Del Norte Medical Center, 12 drawings. That's what we were just looking at. It's from 1961. Fox Plaza, San Francisco, 3 drawings. Crescent Beach Recreation Center, California, 1964, 4 drawings. I think we'll go there. Because I believe I remember this Crescent Beach and it was really pretty. Big folder, y'all. Oh, that's folder 3. Folder 2. Okay. Seriously, look at how big this folder is. It is large. Large folder. Okay. Do you want to see some drawings by an architect that don't look like what we were just looking at? Because if so, today's your day. I have something. Oh, no, I did it again. Stop it. Okay. I am great at this. Can you tell? I have too many moving parts at the moment. Okay. Art. Very 1960s art. You can tell. I don't really know specifically what about it says 1960s. I see it and I know 1960s. But off the top of my head, I can't exactly say why I know it's 1960s. But it definitely reads, oh my gosh, 1960s to me. If anybody can tell me why I know from looking at this, that this is 1960s, do share. Fox Plaza, San Francisco, California. Portico, if you are familiar with Fox Plaza, I'm not. You've seen that lobby. Well, that lobby was designed by Vera Jansone. And I have her architectural materials here. It's a mixed-use high tower. So this is an architectural drawing. This is an architect's artwork, right? This is all illustration. This is drawing number 3, a view of the plaza. Let's see, Victor Gruyan Associates. What's really funny, this is Los Angeles office, I guess. But she was working for a New York architectural firm in California. I'm gonna click on it so I can see. Oh, cool. Neat. And the neat. This is the thing, I have not looked them up prior to stream because it's intended to be somewhat spontaneous. So the way it's designed varies slightly from what that picture showed. Much better. Well, no, maybe it doesn't. There's only one view in the picture that you shared. I was thinking that I couldn't see the plants, but I can see the plants. What I don't see is the couches. Maybe they have been, it's an adventure indeed. But so the lobby here, glassed in space on the back and around an office space here and an office space over here. This opens up to the level above and you've got some columns surrounding a central square area that has a fountain in the middle. And you can see all of these, I don't know, I suppose business people? They're all paired off, person in suit, person in dress, person in suit, person in dress, and then you get person in suit, child, in pants and button-up shirt. We don't like people sitting down or something. Oh, I mean, I'm sure there are reasons. If the building's open to the public, they probably took out the couches to discourage people from sleeping. Because we don't like people who can't afford a home. And then two people in suits together, two people in fashionable 1960s ladies' styles together. This is an elevator bank here. It appears to only have two elevators. Based on the way the lines are drawn here, it looks like just two elevators. Although the bay seems wide enough that it could have three, but I don't know. Has both business offices and residential apartments. Okay, and then there's a staircase, and of course, you know, this is a, this circular object here, not a trash can. That is a cigarette, that's an ashtray for cigarettes, based on its shape and height and size relative to the room. Also, no longer available indoors, indeed. But yeah, that little detail there, I don't actually see a trash can anywhere here in the drawing, but there's an ashtray. These drawings, I think, for me, are one of the more interesting bits of this collection. The other architectural collections that we've looked at were all like architectural drawings. This one has these somewhat more artistic, like, here's my concept of what it's gonna look like. And I'm appreciative of that. I think that they're pretty cool. Let's see, Fox Plaza. This appears to be an exterior of the building. Section B-B, second stage, is what this one is labeled. Oh gosh, thank you, Lord Portico. Oh, wow. Thank you for the link to the exterior shot. The links, for anybody watching like the VOD or whatever, who doesn't have the links or the chat, like once this makes its way over to YouTube, you won't have that anymore. These are just images that are available on the Wikipedia page about Fox Plaza in San Francisco. So fairly easy to find. But yeah, this drawing here, this is kind of cool. This is, again, different than the other drawings that we've looked at in the past, but you've got a second sub-level, a first sub-level, ground floor, then you've got second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, 10th, 11th, and 12th floors, the 13th floor for mechanical, and then a roof area over, like, there's a roof area before you move into the, oh dear, why, I'll fix that in a second. The second tier, which, so, I neglected to pay attention to the labels on the other side. So let's look at them. It doesn't define what's in the sublevels. So, you know, that could be vampire housing, that could be werewolf housing, that could be secret government agencies, maybe that's where, you know, sorry, I'm not familiar enough. First sublevel is parking. I was gonna say essentially like James Bond, but I wanted the American version, but is there an American version? Anyway, I thought I would try and make a joke, and that probably a vampire club. Indeed, yes, probably a vampire club. 16-bit Eric, hello! Thank you so much for the raid. Welcome in, Raiders. It's great to see you. We are looking at the Vera Jansone Architectural Collection today, and we are having fun looking right now at drawings of Fox Plaza in San Francisco. Also, just, wow, hello. If anybody is here on either channel who is not already following 16-bit Eric, it is well worth a follow. You should definitely drop a follow. I'm gonna try and use the new shout out feature. I have done it incorrectly. I'll fix that in a moment, but Eric is a wonderful streamer who does a lot of TTRPG related content, so TTRPGs are something that we use for educational purposes here at Virginia Tech, and if you want to learn more about them, there's nobody better to learn from. So you should drop a follow over for 16-bit Eric there. Anybody coming in who does not know who I am Rogan27, since that's the channel you came in on. I am also the Community Collections Archivist here at Virginia Tech, and Wednesdays I share things from the archives. I'm streaming to two channels, twitch.tv/VTULstudios and twitch.tv/Rogan27. And yeah, I pull different things every week. This week just happens to be an architectural collection that has some pretty iconic buildings and some pretty iconic artistic style. But hi, Rikar, thank you so much for the 22-month resubscription. And some Silica for the 10-month resubscription. And how do you do the new command, Lord Portico? Thank you for dropping the about. Hi, I am Puddle Glum. Be Right UK, thank you for the 22-month resub. Hi, It's good to see you. Also, it appears that there is a hype train going on the Rogan 27 channel. So thank y'all for that. Hi, Costabras. It's slash, oh, yeah. I see what I did wrong. I tried just slash SO and that didn't work. So if anybody is watching on the VTUL Studios and you don't already follow 16-bit Eric, there should be a button there for you to go ahead and drop a follow if you want. Rekar, oh look, a train. Wow, we're at 94%. I am gonna start looking at the materials again though, for anybody who is just joining, Vera Jansone is the name of the architect that we are looking at materials from today. She was born in Latvia and ended up working in California. She went to the Ecole des Beaux Arts and the Atelier de Le Corbusier. She studied with, studied under Mies van der Rohe at the Illinois Institute of Technology, before working in New York and then working in California. Rikard, thank you for the 1,000 bits. Oh my gosh. So we're looking at Fox Plaza in San Francisco. And we were looking at, we were just debating what the sub-levels are for in this building, because we have two sub-levels and everything else on this drawing says what they're for. The sublevels don't. So we were guessing that maybe they were for, that was where the vampires live, or they were for like Men in Black, secret government agency type stuff. And then Lord Portico pointed out they're actually for parking. But under the parking, in the second sublevel, we don't know what's there. ground floor, second floor are labeled as commercial. And we are at 50% of level 2. Thank you very much. I wish I could have alerts on this stream. If you were here for my gaming streams on the weekend, there would be alerts that go off, but not for this stream, sadly. I'll have to think of how I can implement those, because they would be good. I'd love to have them. It's just a much more complicated setup here, and I need to figure out how to control them. Anyway, now I'm distracting myself. Floors 3 through 12 are labeled as office floors, so Portico confirmed that this building is actually mixed-use offices and residential. The 13th floor, you know, the floor nobody would actually want to spend time on, because this is a building in America and 13 is not a number that Americans like. The 13th floor is mechanical equipment floor. Yeah, and there's the elevator pit here, so that is where the elevators run. So then from floors 14 through 29 are apartments. This is residential up here, where the windows change, and then the 30th floor, which is not labeled with the number 30, it is an equipment floor, and it says mechanical equipment dash penthouse. So I don't know if that means that there's a penthouse as well as mechanical equipment, or if it is just mechanical equipment. I don't know. And then we have the roof above that. If you're not mixed use in San Francisco, what are you doing? I'm not sure, Bastion Cider. But this was a building being designed. This architectural drawing for the building is dated August 5th, 1963. And we've already, Portico did share links out to some images of the building on the, there's a Wikipedia article about Fox Plaza. So if you wanted to look it up, a quick search on Wikipedia for Fox Plaza San Francisco should get you some images to look at if you wanted to see exterior and the lobby and some things like that. It's a penthouse for mechanical equipment. Only the fanciest mechanical equipment gets housed there. Indeed, indeed, Fast Insider. That sounds about right. So this drawing is labeled typical apartment floor. Gross area, 18,460 square feet, 2,200 square feet of balconies. I can zoom in if anybody would like me to show off specific detail. In fact, I might zoom in, but right now I do want to get sort of as much of an overview of this as we can get. Amazingly, I have something big enough that I can't get the entire thing on screen at once, which is new with, wow, I think there's some, I don't know why static would be. Anyway, never mind. I am distraction. Apartment adjacent to interior snake. Apartment adjacent to, smoke. To exteriors. Okay, we're gonna zoom in a little so we can look and see the detail a little bit better. Hi, Hannah. Now that stream has been going for an hour, you can finally sit down and watch Too Many People. I mean, it's been architectural drawings, but so yeah, today is Vera Jansone Architectural Collection, and she works in some very iconic styles. In fact, if we drop the finding aid link, essentially, her work is primarily in the international and mid-century modern architectural styles. Do they have architecture tours in San Francisco? I don't know. I don't actually know. I'm nowhere close to San Francisco, so I couldn't tell you. Our collections, like I said, I'm at Virginia Tech in Southwest Virginia. And we house the International Archive of Women in Architecture, which is why we have this collection here, because Vera Jansone was a woman in architecture. All right, so this is an apartment floor. I don't see on the drawing, and I don't believe that I have in this folder a key for what the letters are. So we'll do our best. Tend to look at the painted ladies and the Victorian style buildings. I will say, I'm not disappointed in you, Lord Portico, about not knowing if there were architecture tours in San Francisco. The place you are least likely to know what touristy things there are to do is the place you live. Because where you live, you've never done the touristy things. Unless you've had people come to visit you who wanted to do touristy things. You've not been to Alcatraz? I haven't either, but I don't think I've ever been to San Francisco, so. Oh, Hannah, I'm sorry. Okay, so we've got, I'm uncertain. This is a stairwell. That's what this is. This is a stairwell. apartment D1 here. We have a living area, kitchen, and dining. A pass-through closet area with a bathroom. And then the bedroom here. It does look like it opens possibly to a balcony from the bedroom. I'm not certain. There's definitely a balcony over here. And this appears to be a closet in behind the bathroom sink. Apartment A here. Looks like the living area is larger. There's a balcony and a little storage space off the balcony. Kitchen, but no dining area in with the kitchen, so separate. Pantry, which is lovely. It looks like there's maybe a coat closet or a linen closet here. Coming in here to the bathroom, you've got the toilet, you've got a shower space, you've got the sink, you've got two closet areas. What I don't see is a bedroom. So I would count A as like a studio, because there's no, in fact, this whole side here doesn't have bedrooms. The A, the C1, the B, the C, the C. So the letters are indicating, I think, floor plan. But everything on this side of the building has no bedrooms. So this is all, yeah. And it says living/sleeping. So yeah, everything, the A, the B, the C, the C1, they are all studio apartments. The D, is a one bedroom. So if you enter, you're entering D from the hallway, you enter here, and then immediately turn a corner, you've got a pass through here. So the D is very similar to the D1, which is the first one that we looked at. But you pass through the bathroom, and you've got your bedroom there with a large closet and a balcony. And then this direction, you've got your living area, balcony, storage, kitchen, pantry. And then here is another D, but flipped. What I find interesting, though, is that one doesn't show where the bedroom is. Oh, it's right here. I was seeing the apartment as this, but it's actually all of that for that apartment. There's a detail of this apartment. Two bedroom apartments on the lower floors. That might be the next drawing. We'll take a look and see. No bed for you. You sleep in the bathtub. The reason why this one is special is that this is the interior smoke tower. So this is an open space that goes from the bottom floor all the way to the top to let out smoke if the building catches on fire. I'm not sure where the exterior smoke tower one is. I have another detail, and I'm looking to see if I can locate where it is on the drawing. I'm not sure. Like, I feel like it would be here, but it doesn't match. We'll find out. A fancy emergency chimney. Yeah. Huh. I don't... So this upper detail drawing here that says apartment adjacent to X smoke tower stair at 14th floor. I'm not sure where it is on the drawing though. Like I don't know which apartment that is. I feel like it would be here, but I don't think it is. However, this one, I have to angle it because there's a thing in the way. So this is this apartment here. You've got the open court. You've got this. This is the like the fire escape with the stairs, stairs up to the roof, stairs going down. So the entrance to the apartment is over here. And you've got a closet. And you've got kitchen and dining combined. Literally just the kitchen is on one wall. Living room, bedroom slash den, balcony, bathroom. So usable apartment space is actually this. It's just a different shape apartment. But because of the requirement of having this open court area, it necessitated doing something different with at least one of those living spaces. So that's a typical apartment floor according to the drawing. See what else we have. As I try desperately to move them without damaging any of these large pieces of paper. Crescent Beach Recreation Center. As far as I can tell, this was never built. I did do a little bit of looking to see because the image that I picked for the cover image for this week was one of the Crescent Beach Recreational Center drawings. But as far as I can tell in my searching, I don't think this ever got made. Site plan, November 1961. So this is for a beach rec center area. You know, since the name said recreation center, I guess I didn't need to specify that. But I did anyway. So we have, again, very detailed drawing here. This is expert level drawing. It's very precise. Everything is measured, but you've also got like the 3D rendering of the buildings here to scale. Everything is to scale, but you can see like the shadow to give it the depth so that it's a top-down three-dimensional view. You've got the individual freaking trees, which is just somewhat mind-boggling to me. Actually, I think these are rocks, like boulders. Anyway, Pebble Beach Drive, Ocean Drive, Play Street, Front Street. And then we've got G, H, I, J, K, and L streets there. A surf hotel there. We have a public park and a picnic grounds. I'm not 100% certain what all these circles are. I was thinking they were boulders because of their placement on the beach. But then the notice is here, I wonder if they are actually trees along the park here. I'm not certain. Yes, this is where it would be. It's not, because as far as I can tell, it never got built. It does not exist. I think it's an amazing plan, though. So you've got shops over here. You have a timber museum. I wonder what goes in the timber museum. Is it a museum of timber? Or a museum about, like, the timber industry? Was timber a big industry out in, like... Is this San Francisco? Where is Crescent Beach? I don't even know where Crescent Beach is. Was timber big in Crescent Beach? These things I do not know. Parking, of course. Of course. America is built around cars, so parking. A playground area, a bowling alley, an information center. There's a gas station planned to be here. And let me tell you, in the city, back in Crescent City again, Northern California near Oregon. So timber industry, probably a big deal. In a city, honestly, any city, planning for a gas station, excellent idea. Given that America is built around cars, but not around having them fuel up in cities. You've got a coffee shop. I believe, so it doesn't, it looks like it was erased, though. This coffee shop is connected to something. It looks like it may have said hotel at one point. I don't know what the first word is. There's a little pond here. You can tell because it's colored in like water. Obviously. Garden units. So these are, I think, little like cabins where people could stay? I'm uncertain. Garden units. Sauna. I believe this is a covered walkway that connects the shops over here and the open-air theater to the sauna. There's a swimming pool, enclosed, I-N-C-L-O-S-E-D, meaning it's covered, a covered swimming pool. There's a terrace and a restaurant and terrace coffee. You have a boardwalk along here. And this is the dock, and leading out to where you've got little canoes and a, looks like a river and pond or lake area here. So a beach, but it looks like a beach on a lake rather than like an ocean beach, based on the plan. They finally removed parking requirements for transit-oriented development in California. It's very exciting. That's awesome. It wouldn't work where I am here in Southwest Virginia without some major changes, because this area is not big on the transit. It is possible to live here without a car. I know people who do. It is not easy and not inexpensive to live here without a car. So here we have the same site plan, but in color, which lets me know that these are indeed trees and not boulders. When I was thinking that this was going to be like a ocean beach, I was expecting boulders for the circles. But it is definitely trees. They are colored in green. These are really nice.
So, so pretty.
Oh, gosh. We have a perspective view of the same thing. Oh, wait until you see the last one in this folder. There's a reason it caught my eye. Crescent Beach Recreation Center, the non-existent recreational paradise of yesterday's future dreams. I think that sentence may have actually parsed out to make sense, but I don't actually know for sure. A perspective view. Tilted, I don't know the actual angle that this is rendered at. I'm gonna say roughly 45, 50 degrees possibly. I'm not 100% certain though. And let me tell you, estimation of anything mathematical, not something my brain does well. So, you know, whatever. We've got, so this is the swimming area. Trying to remember this, there was supposed to be a coffee shop. This is the sauna. That's the coffee shop there that was attached to something that used to say hotel, but didn't say hotel anymore. These were the garden buildings. There were like shops. There was a terrace coffee. This was the cafe. Shops was here. This is the open air theater. That was the Timber Museum. I can't recall. There was a sauna hotel, but I thought it was on the other side of the street. I don't remember specifically what that was. But here you've got the boardwalk, you've got the dock with the canoes or other, I guess they're not canoes, they're bigger boats than I was thinking. You strongly approve of all these coffee shops. Take a point of stress there, Bastion Cider. Sorry. Having Eric raid my stream has me thinking of the alien RPG rules, and coffee gives you a point of stress there. Anyway, this is a lovely, this seems like a great place to just go and spend some time when you're okay to spend time around people. This looks like it would have been awesome. But you want to know what it would look like from street level? In color? That's a tall order. But I have it. Nineteen sixties. Illustration. Let me see what it says on the back, in case it says something. It doesn't. So, Crescent Beach Recreation Center. This is, of course, an illustration of it by Vera Jansone, the architect, for George S. Gatter and Associates, planning consultants. And of course, they were based out of San Francisco. I don't know what time of day this is meant to be. The dark color of the sky, I sort of assume this is like a dusk. Because I feel like this is a lamp. I don't know. This to me looks like a street light. So I picture this as a dusk scene. And I'm not certain where we are. Like, is this a cafe? We've got the very 1960s silhouette for cars. Although this could be the Timber Museum. I'm gonna have to pull out one of the other drawings again. Just so that I can sort of get my bearings, because now I'm really curious. I am curious. It's definitely not the swimming pool area. Okay, yeah, so this is the restaurant. Based on the shape of the building, the building sides, that seems to be this building here. Only then it doesn't make sense. Maybe it's the bowling alley. What is this? So this is me trying to figure out where we are. There's a road going through. Between the buildings. Ah! No, I know where we are. I figured it out. Thank you to this building right here. This building with the pointed top. That is the information center, which means this is the bowling alley. And this is the coffee shop attached to hotel? It just says, so the building on the right is this one over here. It's this building. I don't know if we're looking at the corner of the coffee shop or the corner of, I think we're looking at the corner of this longer section that used to say something hotel. So I don't know what that building is. But then in the distance, the pointed building was the information center, and then we've got the bowling alley with what I thought was a streetlight, but is definitely the, it's a bowling ball. That's a bowling ball. But anyway, I think this is an amazing drawing. I love this drawing. It's the precise artwork that you get from an architect who's used to precise measurements. They want to depict their buildings accurately, but you've got tons of detail in here. You've got, but you also just have impressions of the pine trees here. These are done very artistically. They are not meticulous like the buildings. They are, it's the impression of a pine tree and the impression of a pine tree and the impression of a pine tree. And if you watch like Bob Ross, if you watch reruns of the PBS Bob Ross and the Happy Little Trees and whatnot, it's the suggestion of a tree. And it is just like you see on programs about how to paint. The suggestion of the tree is all you need. Here we've got some very thin pines with just a couple of sparse branches. Some trees have apparently been cut down. Timber industry, right? There was the Timber Museum. And like over off to this area, this is more wildernessy on the plan. Yeah, so this area is sort of just fading off because it's not, it's, if you go further this direction, you would be able to see the Timber Museum off over, off the left side of the page. A large tree here, the cars. You've got the outline of very 1960s car silhouettes, and then you've got them sort of colored in with blue and brown and white, or yellow, sorry. But when you look, and if you compare, I'm gonna zoom in actually, just so you can see the detail, because I think this is really cool. And I love this piece in particular from this collection. We're so gonna run out of time. Compare the two blue cars. One is at rest and one is in motion. And despite them being drawn almost identically, they're the same shape, they are the same shade of blue, the motion comes through, which is, so the fill in, the blue for this car is sort of like swirls. It's been applied, and you can sort of see that it's been applied, it's more blobby, it's more like a circular motion was used to fill it in. And that matches the brown car here and the yellow car here. But if you look at this car, it's been shaded in with the same blue and the same charcoal colors, but it's been shaded left to right and actually sort of fades out once you get to the tip of the car. And just that difference in how the color was added into the car conveys the sense that this car is moving along the road. And the same is sort of there for the brown car here. Like, I think these cars are driving. I don't think they're parked on the side of the road. I think they're driving. And I think that that was conveyed through the way that they were drawn. But then when you get to the actual, like, architecture portions of it, you've got the detail. You've got, on the bowling alley here, these are like little curved sections of wall between each of these where it juts out. It's like curved in. Very meticulous on, you can see the large concrete blocks. You can see this open area here with sort of the angular awnings that are very characteristic of like a 1960s mid-century modern style. You've got the glass sort of entryway here, and then you've got the cinder block wall that's built up here in a nice beige cinder block. And then this is the covered walkway that goes off towards towards the Timber Museum. If you followed this pathway out of the bowling alley, you would eventually arrive at the Timber Museum. And then that is sitting across the street from this very rustic looking, like, this is very stone. This is very like modern, 1960s stone. And then you get this, which is a very Pacific Northwest, out in the woods, 60s. You still have the large glass openings, but they're accented by these wooden, the wooden cross sections in the windows themselves. There's the wooden balcony with the wooden overhang. And down below, this is like slat fencing almost for the lower section here. So very, it's glass on the, like full glass wall, but wood. So you have this juxtaposition of the very stone, sleek, modern 1960s with something a bit more rustic and a bit more outdoor woodsy. And they're right across the street from one another, and they marry well, like, they marry perfectly together. And I think they're expertly illustrated, both of them. This is a place where I would love to have gone and seen this in person if it had ever been actually built. It's amazing. I think this piece of art, she did an amazing job with this. This is a wonderful concept. And basically, like, a concept for an entire, like, neighborhood. Yeah, it's not residential. This is a commercial neighborhood. This is a recreational neighborhood. But it is the entire neighborhood. And I think it's awesome. This is, I think, my favorite thing that I found in the collection. And I have spent a lot of time sharing it with you. We maybe have time to take a peek at one more thing before it will be time for me to start packing up. Let's see. Should we look at a BART station? Bay Area Rapid Transit. She designed a few of those. Woo! Again, very large pieces of paper here. Two of the elevators in the building, the two elevators, the two largest elevators, are out of service. So I had to go in the smaller elevator that the students ride, which, not a big deal. The elevator was still big enough. It's just a very big, very busy elevator and hard to make sure. I took up most of the elevator. Definitely from the 50s and 60s. Let's see, BART station, oversized folder 3. I don't even have to open the boxes, which is cool. BART. Let us see. Architecture. Architecture is what brings us together today. That was really silly, and I apologize because it was also really bad. But also, I don't apologize because it was fun to say. BART stations. I'm gonna zoom all the way out. This is me filling time while I'm getting things in place to share. First drawing here we have the San Francisco Bay Area Rapid Transit District. Corlette Spackman Ernst Born Architects in Joint Venture. This is the Balboa Park Station. Cross section looking north. So the cross section looking north, got space for the train. Have to have exact measurements and know the shape of the train. Looks like a 2-foot, 6-inch wall on one side of the train. Got the platform design here. Approximate scale of a person. I was looking to see if the height of the person was listed. It is not, but the height clearance planned above the person appears to be 9 feet. Look, this is for the signage. We've got a mezzanine. I don't know what all of the things I'm looking at are, but bad link breaks. No. A what? You've got a freaking image from Wikipedia of a northbound train at Balboa Park Station. Amazing. I'm gonna attempt to copy. and paste so that I could see it myself, because... Oh dear. Yeah, that didn't work. I found it. Oh, wow. Oh, gosh, I didn't realize it was open to the sky from the drawing. My brain goes to the Washington, D.C. metro stations, which are primarily underground, because that's the metro stations that I grew up with. So it didn't even occur to me that it was open to the sky. Has a partial second level. Well, we have some illustrations beyond this. This is a cross section. We've got other stuff here. Let's see. Mission Line, Bosworth Station, Plaza level. Balboa Park Station is nearing the edge of San Francisco. Well, so this is the Mission Line, Bosworth Station, alternate with new buildings. Plaza level. Hi, Santa Man. Two-thirds above ground and a third underground. Okay. So this appears to be Bosworth Street, Diamond Street, and Circular Avenue. And this is a top-down view of a BART station on the Mission Line. Looks like there's a bank, or was a bank. I'm looking to see the date. I don't see the date. I'm sure it's on here somewhere, but also would have been the 60s. But, so we have that view, but then we also have this detail here that is meant to be viewed with that as the top. Below ground. So you've got the bank. You've got the bank basement. You have a library. With apparently toilets under the library on the mezzanine level. And then below the mezzanine level here, you actually get the two train platforms. Still, this is still the Balboa Park Station? No, it says Bosworth. Toilets at a BART station? You used to ride it 5 days a week. The weirdest part was knowing when you were under the bay and there was a whole lot of water above you. Amazing. Yeah, I'm not familiar with toilets at mass transit stations, except for certain New York subway stations that actually do have toilets, and they are useful. So this is another alternate view of this is the mezzanine level of Bosworth Station. So there's the bank basement, the public library that you apparently enter from Bosworth Street, but was built and designed along with the BART station. And then this is the mezzanine above. And so you would actually descend these escalators here to get down to the platform. This would be the turnstiles. And apparently on the platform level is where the toilets were designed to be. There's no library there now. BART stations outside of San Francisco all had usable toilets. There was a 9 out of 10 shot that it was not something you'd want to touch if you had any alternative. Interesting. Incidentally, didn't George Takei work for quite a long time on the BART system. Wasn't he involved in administration of San Francisco's mass transit system in some way? I seem to recall that George Takei was involved in that. Oh, you didn't know? I'm gonna have to look it up to confirm. I know he worked on mass transit in San Francisco. Or I think it was San Francisco. Now I'm gonna have to double check. I know he did mass transit. All right, we're gonna check this. I'm gonna find out what I have said incorrectly. Let's see. I'm trying to find it. His Wikipedia article wants to talk all about his work in television. DNC. Maybe it was LA's transit system. He was on the board of directors of the Southern California Rapid Transit District. So not BART, but transit. So I did not have the details correct, but I did know that he was involved with transit. He was part of the team that initiated and planned the LA subway system. So not BART, the LA subway system. Anyway, it was just a thing where I was like, it popped into my head and then I said it and then it was wrong. So this is why we look up things. Glen Park Station, outside benches. Apparently, they were designed to have granite tops. With a little gutter at the back, which makes sense. But they were designed to be completely smooth granite along the top. I would be surprised if they are still completely smooth granite today. Let's see, Glen Park Station. What is that? Glen Park and Bosworth. All right, I think this is the last thing that we're gonna look at today, which is another of Glen Park Station. This is building surroundings, east elevation. I think there are more BART-related things in the collection. I'm not certain, though. Yeah, box 5 has Bosworth Station. Box 6 has Civic Center Station. Box 7 has Civic Center Station. 8 has Glen Park Station. 9 has Market Street, Montgomery Station, Market Street Civic Center Station, Balboa Park. There are quite a lot of BART-related items in here. Yep, Portico, thank you for the reminder. So yeah, that there's more BART drawings in the collection than what we saw, but I'm comfortable with what we've shared. So she apparently did design a lot of the stations, or a lot being 5 or 6, at least. I am not great at reading this. This is a side view of the station. And I believe ground level is up here and train level is down here. And I see you come across here, there's some stairs going down, and then there's this. And then at some point between here and here, I don't know what happens. Unless this continues out here, and you've got some way down in here. Or this could be the train level, I don't know. Because this might be down. No, I'm guessing train level's down here. So at some point along behind what we're seeing here, because this is the exterior view, I'm guessing you get the escalators down and whatnot. I'm not certain. I'm guessing this might be leading up to like an office or something that is under this walkway. It's hard for me to know. But this is an exterior view, and we have the suggestion of some stairs here. So I think this is an office that you reach from inside. But without like the explanation, like the write-up for this drawing, it's hard to tell. But anyway, it's no big deal. We don't have to know. These were designed, and somebody was able to read them and actually build these things. Because there is a Glen Park station, and I bet it is to this design, or at least was. Glen Park Station! Thank you. You're amazing. I'm going to copy this, I'm going to paste this, I'm going to see what it looks like. Oh, neat. Interior view there. Nice. It's just a very big empty space. Well, that comes across in the drawing. San Francisco Muni train line. Oh, cool. At the very, very top up here. That's a like a local light rail system. Above ground rail. Interesting. All right, I'm gonna start wrapping up the show because it is past 4:30. I do need to start packing up to be ready to head out. So we're gonna stop there with the Vera Jansone collection. As I did say previously, if you want to look at some more of this stuff, a lot of this collection has been digitized. I think the Finding Aid should hopefully mention that.
Does the Finding Aid mention it?
Well, apparently not. But if you want to peek around and see if you can find items from this collection online, I don't know for sure if they've made their way online. There are notes saying they've been digitized. I just don't know if they're online yet. But if you go to iawa.lib.vt.edu, which I can type that link in. If you go there and search for Vera Jansone, you should find out pretty quickly. I'm going to try it right now. It does not, to me, look like any of the digitized items have made their way onto that site yet, but someday they will make their way to the site. They have been digitized with the intent of getting them up there. It's just a matter of that's work. But you can, if you want to see more similar content, feel free to explore that site. That is the site for the International Archive of Women in Architecture, of which this is one collection. What we have coming up next week on Archival Adventures is a set of, I believe, 7 volumes of a pulp horror / fantasy magazine called Whispers. Whispers Fantasy and Horror Magazine. And we're gonna take a look at that, probably read some short stories out of it, and have as good of a Halloween-y, spooky season time as we can, since that will be the last stream before Halloween. So hopefully some of you can come and join me once that comes around. My computers are way off to the sides today, which is why I keep looking side to side. I do want to say thank you very much for joining me today. It's been a lot of fun, despite how scattered I've been. It has truly been a lot of fun. I'm glad you were all able to join me. Thank you very much, Eric, for the raid earlier. Thank you everybody who dropped a resubscription or bits over on the Rogan27 channel. I very, very much appreciate that. Let me see who we're gonna say hello to today. I think I am lost. No, not that channel. Don't go there. I'm trying to keep this computer from going to sleep. Hi. Can you not do that right now, computer? Thanks. Show me channels I can read. I'm gonna get this. Everything's so far away from me. I was trying to do it on the, like, right in front of me. All right. I see who is live now. And I think we could pop in where we've been going the past couple weeks if you all want. And say hello to Steven for some Coral Island, or we could. I'm looking for to see if anything relevant to today's stream content is there, and I'm not seeing anything. So yeah, I think we're just gonna pop over, say hello to Steven, a wonderful community, many, many librarians over there. If you're not already following Steven, you should. I'm gonna set up these raids. So many moving parts to running a stream, but I do appreciate you all being here. Again, thank you for joining me. I look forward to seeing you again in the future. I think I have done things properly. We'll see in a moment. But yes, thank you for joining me. Hopefully I see you soon. Until I do, keep exploring history, stay curious, and I will see you next time. Bye.